Hey, man, it's me, Kevin Smith. Are you listening to the right podcast? Because you're supposed to be listening to Three Guys in a Flick. Are you listening to that right now? Then you're in the right place. Enjoy.
Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. The show is about to begin.
I'll smoke it with you, bro. We'll go to the loony bin together. I don't give a fuck. Welcome back. You are listening to Three Guys in a Flick. This is where we review the good, the bad, and the absurd. Tonight's episode, Grandma's Boy. Beware spoilers. Coming to you from, well, Grandma's house, my name is Don. And to my right, we have the comic book guy, John.
All right. Who wants a piece of the gray bush?
That's good. And to my left, we have the professor, Ken.
Hello, everybody.
John, if I've told you once, I've told you 1,000 times. Quit bogarting the bong and pass it back this way. Thanks, buddy. Thanks.
Oh, here, catch.
You should never throw a bong, kid. Ever. Tonight, we are talking about Grandma's Boy. Grandma's Boy comes to us from the Bronco Helmet and was submitted to us by one of our listeners, Colum. Colum is a friend of Keenan's, and here tell a bunch of Keenan's buddies listen to us on the regular. So, boys, thank you so much for listening. Colum, thank you for submitting the movie. This one's for you. Released on January 6, 2006, Grandma's Boy was directed by Nicholas Goosen. Screenplay by Barry Wernick, Alan Covert, and Nick Swartzen. And it stars Linda Cardellini, Alan Covert, Peter Dante, Shirley Jones, Shirley Knight, Joel David Moore, Kevin Nealon, Doris Roberts, Nick Swartzen, and a bunch of other stoners.
Hey, I'm a little confused here. Weren't we supposed to watch the 1922 movie called Grandma's Boy?
Wait.
The one starring Harold Lloyd?
Who the fuck is Harold Lloyd?
It was directed by Fred C. Neumeier. Is that not the one you guys watched?
Yes, dude, that is the one we watched. So you are in luck.
Great. Just wanted to check. So how'd the movie do, Don?
This movie had a budget of $5 million, and in the box office, it brought in $7 million. And post-box office, it's brought in over $50 million in DVD sales. This is one of those movies that's definitely a cult classic.
Yeah, I guess Nick Swartzen revealed in an interview that Blockbuster lost a lot of money on this movie.
Why is that?
Because when it came out on VHS, it was the number one stolen movie. People did not want to return it.
Interesting. Did you see it in the theater by chance?
No. You know, what's funny is for the longest time, I didn't even know about this movie. I found this movie just surfing along, trying to find something to watch, ran across it, watched it, and fell immediately in love with it.
Yeah. Yeah. That's kind of how it happened for me. Had you ever seen this movie?
Never even heard of it.
That's what I was thinking. For me, I was working at that infamous insurance company way back when, and the people I was hanging out with, they had talked about it and they kept quoting it. And so I watched it, and as soon as it said Happy Madison, I was in love. Mm-hmm. So there you go.
So this movie doing the box office that it did that year, it ranked 190th in the box office. The first week it debuted at number 13. In the second week, it went on to number 21 and then 35 and then 56. It tanked in the box office.
Yeah.
And interestingly enough, only $500,000 behind it, a little bit further down the list, was A Scanner Darkly.
Oh, really? Yeah. So this does just a little bit better than A Scanner Darkly?
Yeah.
Oh, how funny.
Well, I thought it was interesting that if you go to Rotten Tomatoes and you look up the score of this movie, the critic score is 15%. But then you look at the audience score and it's 83%. So it just kind of shows you there is a cult following to this movie.
Oh, absolutely. And this movie is definitely geared toward certain types of people. And, you know, 83% or whatever it is on Rotten Tomatoes agree that this movie gets them and it's funny. And I'll say it right now. This movie gets me and I think it's funny. Mm-hmm. So there you have it.
All right, so a little trivia question. So this movie doing so poorly in the box office, I'm going to give both of you an opportunity to guess what the number one box office movie was that year, and I'm going to give you four choices.
Okay, I like this game.
All right, so in no particular order, Pirates of the Caribbean, Dead Man's Chest, Shrek 2, Star Wars Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith, and your fourth choice is Spider-Man 3. All sequels.
Which
movie came out the same year as Grandma's Boy?
Which movie was number one?
Yes,
okay.
That year.
Okay, so Dead Man's Chest, Sith, Shrek 2, and...
Spider-Man 3.
I'm going to say it was Shrek 2.
I was going to go with Pirates.
The correct answer is Pirates of the Caribbean, Dead Man's Chest.
Oh, well, there you go. Which one's the Dead Man's Chest? Is that the one with the mermaids?
That's the second one.
Oh, it's the second one.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I guess you said
sequel. So out of those four movies, which one was the highest grossing movie out of those four? I will give you the dollar amounts. In no particular order, there's 423, 336, 441, and 380. Which one was the highest of those four?
I'm saying it Pirates still.
It was Shrek 2. Shrek 2 had 441.
Well, let's talk about Happy Madison for a sec. Now, most people are familiar with what the Happy Madison is. It's Adam Sandler's production company that makes a lot of movies and now has moved into, I guess, making TV as well. Do you know how many movies they have made to date?
52.
52 movies. Now, of those 52, he likes to put his friends, obviously, in his movies. They always seem to appear in his movies. And so I was trying to do a little research, figuring out, you know, like looking at this current movie, who's appeared most. If you look at Nick Swarson, he's appeared 19 times in Happy Madison movies. Peter Dante, 16 times. Alan Covert, 36 times. So he's, out of the 52 movies, he's been in 36 of them.
Oh, I believe it. Alan Covert has been in every Adam Sandler movie from when he started. I mean, he was in Grown Ups as well, so.
Yeah, I went and looked just at his like film list, and I think there's only like one or two movies he's been in that wasn't an Adam Sandler movie.
Yeah. I think it's great that Adam Sandler gets a production company, and Happy Madison, obviously Happy Gilmore, Billy Madison, the movies that kind of launched him to what he would become. And I don't give a fuck what anybody says. I'm a huge Adam Sandler fan. So with his name attached to this, if it's good enough for Adam, it's good enough for me to at least give it a shot. So, yeah.
Real quick, Adam Sandler story.
Fire away.
I had an opportunity to meet him when I was in college. He was doing a comedy tour, and I was helping with the arts entertainment departments where I got to go work the shows and work backstage. And so I remember he went and did a show, and he did a amazing show. He was really, really funny. And he came backstage, and I started to talk to him, and he actually turned to me and said, "Can you just shut up a little bit? I'm working off a hangover."
No way.
So that was my whole conversation with Adam Sandler.
Was he a dick about it, or was he kind of cool about it?
No, he was cool. He just had a really bad headache. I was like, I totally understand. I just kind of walked out of the room.
That's fucking awesome. Grandma's Boy is directed by Nicholas Goosen. I mean, I got nothing. What do you guys do? Have you ever heard of this guy?
I tried to look him up. This was his first directing debut. And as far as I know, there hasn't been anything afterwards.
He just does videos.
Oh, does he?
Video shorts.
Oh, sure. Let's talk about this cast a little bit. We talked about Alan Covert. Normally, he is the sidekick or just a random character or even a cameo. Here, he is the lead. What did you guys think of Alan Covert?
He was fine. I didn't know him from anything else. I've never seen him. How about this? I've never seen him in anything memorable that I go, oh, I know him.
Oh, sure, sure.
Yeah, I'd obviously known him from other Happy Gilmore and other just Adam Sandler projects. I thought he did a really good job, but I don't know why this time through, you know, watching it more critically, he gave me a Vince Vaughn kind of vibe, like a Peter LaFleur from Dodgeball.
I thought he was great. I thought he does a good job as a leading man, and he carries a cast that is carryable, if that makes sense. There's no big stars. There's a couple cameos here and there, but overall, the cast feels like it was woven together very nicely, and I think Alan Covert is the general of that, and I think he does a really good job.
Plus, you're dealing with a lot of people who are maybe comedians on their side gigs or their normal gigs and are really good at ad-libbing. And I think there's a ton of ad-libbing going on in this movie.
Linda Cardellini's in this, and we know her from the MCU. Do you know who she is in the MCU?
I would guess Natasha's sister.
Oh, for fuck's sakes.
Who is she?
Does she ring a bell to you there, guy?
She's Hawkeye's wife.
Bam, in your face, all over it.
Well, even. She wasn't blonde in the MCU, so I didn't know that.
She's Velma as well.
Yes. Yes, she is. What'd you think of her in this movie?
Oh, and I also knew her first from ER.
My God, Professor, you were right. Now rings a bell. Yeah. Yeah. What'd you think of her?
She was my favorite character.
Yeah, she was fun and lively.
And she wasn't necessarily dismissive towards anybody. And she was, you know, glasses half full type of person.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree.
I thought she worked well as kind of, at least for the first almost half of the movie, kind of being the straight man, being the straight person, to let the comedy, you know, bounce off her. And then it was refreshing to see her guard come down and her kind of join the group.
Yeah, I really liked her as well. And I liked where her character went.
Peter Dante.
He's in all of Adam Sandler's as well. And I think that with Peter Dante, he just plays Peter Dante in every role because he's kind of the same guy.
I felt like he had some of the best lines in this movie.
Oh, he definitely did. And it's the delivery and I just think he's cute. You know, I think he's funny. What'd you think of Dante?
He was a fun character, but I don't know him from anybody.
Sure. Nick Swartzen.
I don't know why you'd think just by the roles he plays that you'd get annoyed with him, but I always find him funny. There's something about him. I always find just like a cute funny.
Yeah. What'd you think?
He was fine. I've never seen him before. I don't remember him from anywhere.
Yeah.
He was in that Adam Sandler movie with Jennifer Aniston.
Just Go With It.
Just Go With It.
He was also in Grown Ups 2.
Yeah.
And I know him from Benchwarmers and I just fucking had it again.
Larry.
Oh, no.
The Chuck and Larry movie.
Yes, very much Chuck and Larry. I think that he's great in that one, but also in Blades of Glory.
Blades of Glory. That's one of my favorite roles.
Yeah, that's a hidden gem.
That's the only movie out of those bunches that I've seen, and I've only seen Blades of Glory once.
Oh, yeah, he was the stalker.
Yeah, well, if you ever get some free time, we just named off some gems. Oh, and how could I forget? He's in my favorite Adam Sandler movie of all time. You Don't Mess with the Zohan.
Yeah.
Along with Linda Cardellini being the best character, I think Shirley Jones is like the second best. And I love the fact that they got Mrs. Partridge to play that character.
Mm-hmm.
And when she gets down with Nick Swartzen, it just makes me laugh. So I thought she did a great job.
I just love her banter with Alan Covert's character in that, you know, it's okay to be gay.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's okay.
You know Shirley Jones, right?
Yeah.
Okay. What'd you think?
Partridge Family. Yeah. Yeah, she was fine. She was fun. But I will say that it was a little jarring for me when she started having the relationship with Jeff. Oh my God.
Well, you know who else it was jarring for? Nick Swartzen said that his scenes with her were extremely awkward because her husband liked to be on set anytime she was filming. So he was there staring at Nick every time he was making out with her. His hands were roaming. They were doing any kind of scenes. He says it was really hard to do those scenes.
Oh, her husband fucking loved it. Don't let him fool anybody. Joel David Moore, JP, we know him from Dodgeball.
Yep. Right.
Yeah. And I think this is where I first saw him. So when I saw Dodgeball, I went, oh, look, it's JP from Grandma's Boy. What'd you guys think of his character?
I kept thinking every time, you know, I saw him, especially this viewing, that Don, you were watching TV going, oh my God, that's so John. That's so the comic book guy. He's wearing a Matrix jacket and acting like a robot.
Yeah, but you don't do the robot voice, which I appreciate. But yeah, maybe I thought about it a little bit.
Would you like me to start?
Oh, for fuck's sakes. What'd you think there, guy?
I appreciated his inner voice that was his robot voice that was outside.
His nervous voice.
I think my favorite one of his outer voice moments is at the end when he gets busted and he looks at Samantha and he says, please sit on my face. Oh, JP.
I really appreciated the scene with him where he goes up against the wall and is like, how did he see me?
Oh, that was brilliant.
I could see myself. Oh, okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Like
that when I saw that, that made me think of you, John. Absolutely. Kevin Nealon and Doris Roberts round out the cast. Doris Roberts is lovable as Grandma, I thought.
You know, it was actually because my family's always a big fan of Everybody Loves Raymond. My mom used to watch that every night and not get that she was Doris Roberts, that she was that character. So to see her in a movie like this, where she's playing somewhat the similar role, but not, I thought it was really refreshing. I really enjoyed her in this movie. Yeah.
What'd you think?
She was a very likable character. There's nothing to not like about her. She always wanted to feed everybody. She always had a positive outlook on things, and she was willing to be a little bit playful about stuff, especially when she scares Alex at night.
Oh my God, so funny. Or during the party when someone's complaining about cereal, or she just takes it away from him.
No captain for you.
Yeah.
And Kevin Nealon, kind of the hippie. You know, he was good, but I don't think he was kind of a breakout character in this movie.
I liked Kevin Nealon in this. Mm-hmm. He made me laugh. This movie pulls no punches. The jokes are definitely dirty and racy and funny, but yet at the same time, the story is very A, B, and C, and I think it's told well. And yeah, no,
one of the things, I don't know if I, what really drew me to this movie was in the 80s, I used to love really campy movies, stoner movies, ones that just weren't really trying to get, you know, a message or a lesson across. You had your Revenge of the Nerds. You had your, you know, those types of movies. This almost made me feel like they, you know, were trying to recapture that spirit.
I can see that, and I can appreciate that. I love those movies too. And with this one, it's just, it's a fun turn off your brain for an hour and a half and sit back and enjoy the ride. I mean, that's all this movie really is.
Mm-hmm. I think we should talk a little bit about somebody else on the cast. Jonah Hill.
Oh, Jonah Hill. That's right. You know what? I almost forget he's in this movie.
For the longest time, I didn't know that that was Jonah Hill because I didn't even, you know, connect him from Superbad because he looked a little different in this movie.
Yeah, it was surprising to see him because he looks a lot different today.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, it's like, wow.
Okay. I always wonder when they were telling, you know, people were auditioning for roles and they're kind of telling what your role was going to be, how that discussion must have gone with Jonah Hill. Okay, we're going to need you to suck on a woman's boob for like 13 hours. You think you can handle that?
Yeah, you know they don't really do that for 13 hours, right?
I know, but they just imagine like that's a big part of your role is that's what you're going to do.
Oh, sure. And hey, if both parties are consensual and everything's all good, then let the comedy fly.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I say.
That's what they get paid for.
That's right.
Is it about that time?
Well, yes, boys, it is about that time. Welcome to another edition of Master Movie Trivia. I am your reigning champ. You may call me the champ. I have compiled 5 questions and 5 questions only to test your knowledge of the movie we are reviewing. Each question could be worth multiple points, so if you know the answer, say it. And please wait until I finish each question. Question number 1. What is the name of the game Alex has been developing and JP steals?
Demonic.
Demonic 1 to John. Question number 2. Who is Jeff's roommates?
Jeff's roommates.
His grandma.
His parents.
His parents. Oh. Good job. Yes,
Jeff. Sorry.
Bonus question. What kind of bed did Jeff's roommates buy him?
A race car bed.
I'm going to give you guys a tie on that.
A sweet ass car.
Question number 3. Where did grandma find the special tea?
In the urn or whatever, little tin.
It was her deceased roommate's tin of tea.
Where?
In Alex's room.
There you go. Bonus question. What kind of weed was it?
Frankenstein?
Oh, close. Good guess, though, Professor.
Was it the deer?
It was the deer because the fruity roommate or the one who takes all the pills,
she says
something like, oh, I can start seeing the antlers. Mm-hmm. And I dropped dead rolling. So good job, John. John gets the bonus question. Question number 4. What does Alex get his grandma and her roommates in order to get some screen time to finish his levels?
Antique Roadshow.
Nice. Very good. And question number 5. Who proved that Demonic was actually Alex's game?
His grandma.
His grandma, yeah.
Oh, congratulations, Professor. You are the winner this week, and you are one step closer to movie immortality.
Yeah. I definitely should not have smoked the brown bomber because I think someone shit my pants.
You think someone shit your pants?
Yeah, who shit my pants?
Alex is a single 35-year-old video game tester who lives with his friend Josh. When Josh wastes their rent money on Filipino hookers, their landlord, Yuri, evicts them, purposely breaks one of their bongs, and has his movers trash everything that doesn't belong to them, forcing Alex to find a new place to live. Alex tries to stay with his marijuana dealer, Dante, but cannot do so because Dante is adopting a wild lion to live in his house. Alex spends one night with his co-worker, Jeff, but Jeff still lives with his parents. After an embarrassing encounter with Jeff's mother in which he is caught masturbating in the bathroom and subsequently ejaculates on her, she still allows Alex to stay with them. But he has the option of moving in with his grandmother Lily and her two eccentric friends, Bea and Grace. So this movie opens up. It kind of has that, you know, 8-bit graphic.
What game was it?
Galaga.
Galaga, absolutely. One of my favorite games.
Oh, that one. Yeah, I thought you meant what the boxing game was. Mm-mm. And I was like, I don't know, generic computer boxing game. So you have the introduction, pretty standard. We get Rob Schneider. He gives us a little cameo as Yuri. And Kevin Nash comes in as one of the mover guys. Mm-hmm. What'd you guys think of this whole opening bit?
It was fine. You know, I wasn't a bit surprised, you know, that they're getting kicked out.
And we know that it's grandma's boy and he's got to live with grandma. So
yep. It
just moves us along.
I think his name was Paul was the roommate's
Josh.
Name. Oh, it was Josh. Oh, I just love Josh's little bit here where it's like, we pay every week, you know, all the money. And he's like, I love them. He's like, yeah. Like, what? The hookers. I guess while they were filming this scene, Adam Sandler actually came to set to kind of observe and was just dying when, I don't know what prompted it exactly. One of the moving guys said something and Josh said back to him, you're a hooker. And so every time they saw Adam Sandler after that, they had to say to him, you're a hooker. And in response to anything he said.
Oh, yeah.
Because I guess it just cracked him up.
Funny. And so Alex has to go find a place to live. And so he goes over to his drug dealer's Dante's house. And this is our introduction to Dante, and we know this character. I thought it was funny because it feels like Dante doesn't live on this plane of reality.
While being such a stoner, he does say some brilliant things. I mean, he makes sense. You know, when he asks him, why a lion? Why not just get a dog? Well, you can get around a dog.
Yeah, and nobody fucks with a lion. Isn't that what he says?
That's a great point.
And so he can't stay with them, and then he has to go to his cousin's wedding. And I love the introduction here because he's sitting around the table with all the kids and he's teaching them how to beat
the video game. How to conquer a video game.
Yeah. And he was the cool uncle that sat at the table and all the kids wanted to learn from him.
Yeah.
Yeah. I like that bit.
Which I think also kind of showed his maturity level in that he's just a giant kid.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And then we are introduced to Grandma. And she says, your dad says you're looking for a place to live and you can stay with me. Cause she says, Sophie left us. And, you know, Alex not even thinking what that really means. Oh, where did she go?
Heaven.
I thought that was cute. Mm-hmm. There's something to be said about this writing. I think the writing is clever at times.
Yeah. At times. What did you think of him going and staying with Jeff's house?
I love this part because Nick Swardson is such a kid and has no shame about it.
Who doesn't own a onesie pajamas?
Oh, yeah, I agree, but...
With footies?
But we don't live at home with our parents, do we?
No, we don't. They're his roommates.
What's the difference, he says. Because Alex is like, are you sure this is okay? And he's like, yeah, whatever.
The whole thing with him talking about his race car bed, I guess Alan improvised the shut up because with different takes, Nick would just keep going on and ad-libbing about how sweet this bed was. So finally, it was kind of like an Indiana Jones moment where he just goes, shut up. And that's where they decided to end it.
Oh, that's funny. I like that bit because he's so serious about it. And so this leads us to a scene which I thought was pretty funny. Did you guys think this scene was funny?
I thought it was amusing.
Who hasn't been in that situation?
That's not what I asked you. Did you think it was funny?
Yeah, I thought it was funny.
Yeah, and I agree. I mean, who hasn't been in this situation?
It was a Barbie doll dressed up like Tomb Raider.
I know, and the way Alex is talking to it, getting all into it, you knew something was going to happen. Did you guys see Jeff's mom walking in?
Well, first of all, who doesn't lock the bathroom door?
Oh, we've seen enough movies in our lifetime that guys get caught jerking off all the time. So yeah, I guess in movies, bathrooms don't have locks.
Apparently.
Yeah. So we're just going to, yeah. Did you see the mom walking in though?
I assumed somebody was walking in, probably the mom. I didn't expect what happened to happen to the mom.
Neither did I. What about you?
Same. I was surprised that they actually went there with that.
I'm glad they didn't show anything.
Well, yeah. I mean, they're not going to show it, but Alex's face is hilarious.
Well, the dialogue too.
I can't stop coming. It feels too good.
Yeah. I'm so sorry. I can't stop.
He's apologizing. And then they cut to and they're on the street and Jeff's like, dude, if you couldn't sleep, we could have played video games.
Yeah.
You came all over my mom.
I like how he gave him the doll.
Yeah.
And then he does something with the doll. Like he does that licking thing with the doll and he goes, my doll's a whore.
Yeah. Yeah. And I also like the bit where Jeff says, my mom says you could totally still stay over.
Well, that'll be an awkward breakfast.
So it's amusing.
He decides that he's going to go sleep in the office.
And that's where we meet.
The next morning we meet Samantha.
Right. She comes in, she sees him sleeping. She assumes he's been working all night, but we now know that she's new and she's new to the office.
She's basically been brought in to make sure the game finishes up on time.
After that, we have Jeff and Alex. They head to the break room. And they get down to business of rubbing their video game prowessness upon everybody else and how dominating they are.
I love this scene. I thought it was fun. I thought it was put in just in the right moment.
Jeff, he comes out of his shell in such a gregarious way.
He's kind of little reserved, little quippy, but when he opens those doors, all right, motherfuckers, who wants a shot at the title? You know, he just comes out. And yeah, Alex is the champ.
I love that people are making little references or whatever to, and it goes on, you know, on about Alex masturbating on Jeff's mom. And he's like, you know, why did you tell people? I wasn't supposed to tell people.
Yeah, like it was a big shock.
The game that they played, that Frogger type game, whatever it was, did you catch the final score?
Something about 420.
Yeah, Alex scored 420.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yuck, yuck, yuck.
And then after that, we get to meet Mr. Cheezel, the owner, I suppose. And he's talking to Samantha.
While he's doing his yoga on top of his desk.
And we know, just because Kevin Nealon likes to play kind of the same character. He's very free-loving, hippie-style, laid-back kind of boss. And this is also where we meet JP, the boy genius. What do you guys think of this bit?
I thought JP being the wonder kid, I was down with that. And it was striking how skinny he looked underneath that jacket. He looked very lanky. So yeah, he screamed video game nerd, if you will.
My first thought, even before it was mentioned, was this guy just stepped out of the Matrix. This is obviously a guy who is huge into the Matrix.
Do they sell clothes in the Matrix?
Because he had the glasses on, he had the jacket.
There's been so many times that I've seen people dressed like that walking around or doing whatever, and that line comes to my head. Do they sell clothes in the Matrix? Or how much do clothes cost in the Matrix?
No.
That's what it is.
So during the tour, Samantha, she hears a lot of rowdy bantering happening from the break room, and she wants to go in and check it out and see what's going on.
Before she goes in, though, we get kind of the introduction to the fact that JP does not get along with the other testers and everybody because he doesn't want to have anything to do with them. He doesn't want to go in there.
Well, yeah, he's above everybody. Yeah.
That's what I thought immediately.
And Samantha goes into the break room and sees everybody playing games. And I think somebody says something crass and she's like, yeah, don't worry about it. With nowhere else to go, Alex moves in with grandma.
One of the things I meant to bring up was, you know, Dante, the drug dealer, I guess on set, we talked about this kind of when we were watching Scarface, was there was a lot of fake cocaine. Maybe some real cocaine might have gotten smuggled onto the set. Well, in this case, there was a lot of fake weed, you know, during the filming of this. Well, Dante, thought it was a good idea. Peter Dante thought it was a good idea to use real weed, but I guess he didn't take into account how many retakes there would be. So at one point they had to take him to the hospital because he couldn't even walk.
That's a lot of weed.
Yeah.
Alex is given many chores and fix-up projects to do around the house, but has a hard time completing them because his grandmother and her friends are a constant distraction. He also finds it hard to get any work done. After borrowing an illegal cable box from Dante so that he can get cable TV, Alex discovers that the three women have a fascination with the television program Antiques Roadshow, and later is able to get some work finished by giving them tickets to attend a taping of the show. At work, Alex meets the beautiful Samantha, who has been sent by the company's corporate office to oversee the production of the new video game. Alex and Samantha hit it off, but the only person in the way of their relationship is the creator of the game they are all working on, JP, a self-proclaimed genius who is obsessed with video games and has a crush on Samantha. Samantha is not interested in JP and declines his constant advances. Meanwhile, in an attempt to sound cool to his younger co-workers, Alex says that he is living with three hot babes. Alex's friends believe the lie and actually think the reason he is so tired every day at work is because he is living with three women who constantly wear him out in the bedroom. The real cause of his fatigue is because he stays up late working on his own video game called Demonic, which he has been developing in secret for some time. Lily asks about the game one night, and he teaches her to play it. To his surprise, she becomes quite good at it and beats many levels.
Did you know that that Demonic game was supposed to be a real game?
Yeah, didn't Xbox make it, or wasn't Xbox going to release it?
Well, Xbox was going to release it, and it was actually going to be a tie-in to a movie by Clive Barker.
Oh.
So they had it all planned out. The movie never happened. And the company, I think it was Maestros or something like that, they ran out of money.
Yeah, well.
And couldn't finish the game.
That sucks.
It looked like a fun game.
It looked like The Predator. I think the main character like had dreads or something. It kind of looked like The Predator. Am I the only one that thought that?
I didn't think Predator.
Oh.
But the, I guess the other game that we're seeing that they're testing was actually Blood Rain, which I've never actually played, but I have seen videos of it. It looks like a fun game.
Yeah. So Alex moves in with his grandma, and he thinks everything is going to be awesome because when he gets there, naturally, grandma cooks for him and feeds him, and he's thinking, oh, this is great. And this is the bit where she shows him his room, and she tells him this is where Sophie died.
I love the fact that Alex asks, she didn't die in the bed, did she?
Right, and she's like, no, just right over here to the side.
On the floor.
This bit makes me laugh every time I see it when Alex is trying to sleep and then all of a sudden he hears a voice.
Yeah.
And it turns out to be grandma. Did you guys like this bit?
Well, I loved his dialogue. He's like, oh, fuck me. No.
Yeah. I thought it was very sweet that grandma was willing to scare him like that.
It's yeah. Yeah. That sounds like it's going to be a fun house.
Yeah. I don't think I would have fallen back asleep after that.
No, no. But I mean, if you're hearing voices like that, don't you get up and check?
Not if you're stoned.
I don't know. And so the next morning, the grandfather clock goes off.
Right.
6 a.m.
My parents, living at my parents' house, had one of those downstairs that would go off, you know, almost every hour. And I'm such a light sleeper, wake me up every hour.
Oh, I believe it. I believe it. My grandparents had one too. What did you think of Alex getting up, going down for breakfast, and then kissing his grandma and saying, thanks, I'm going to go back to bed now?
Yeah, I thought that was funny. And she's like, no, we've got a few things we'd like you to work on.
Yeah. So it turns out they got themselves a houseboy.
Mm-hmm. And we see him working on all sorts of little projects throughout the house.
What'd you think of their one roommate who was just kind of out of it? She was the one that hauled pills.
B.
And you'd catch her like when he was painting the house, she was eating the paint. And
yeah, she was funny. She was funny. But Shirley Jones's character, she made me laugh.
Mm-hmm. Grace.
Grace B and grandma. And so he goes to work, and this is where
Samantha assigns the guys to break up the levels and go through and look for glitches.
And of course, Alex is asleep during the meeting and lets out a big fart.
That's right. I remember that.
And she's like, nice rip, Alex.
Again, she's fun loving. Mm-hmm. And you know,
JP comes into the meeting afterwards too, being a nerd. Back at home, Grandma is introduced to demonic, and I thought for sure that she was not going to embrace it in any way. But instead, the opposite happens. She decides that she's going to give it a shot, and next thing you know, she's off and going.
Yeah, this is our big, I don't know if this is a good appropriate use of foreshadowing or just a setup for future, but we know that this is going to come back into the movie later on. It's going to play a big part.
Yeah.
Because I love the way he goes to grab for the controller and she slaps his hand away.
Right. Now she's like, fuck off. I'm going to play this.
Yeah. You got to wait your turn, honey.
Right. And in the meantime, or early in the day, Alex tells his buddies that he has three hot roommates and they keep him up all night with sex. And so now there's this rumor, or these guys love him. Right. So they're thinking this is going on.
Well, I love, at some point we find out, we see the TV news that the lion has escaped and Dante's on it.
Right.
On the news going, you know, who the fuck brought a lion into the neighborhood and blah, blah, blah. And he was up in the tree. And so now he's going to get a monkey.
Because we've also been introduced to Dante's friend, Dr. Shakaloo, mm-hmm. which had me rolling all the time.
Well, I love that, you know, they're getting a monkey. Shakaloo's going to get him a monkey, and they're going to teach it Taekwondo.
Yeah.
So what we have now is Dante sets Alex up with a black box for the TV. And Alex, he takes it home, and next thing you know, you're going to, you know, Grandma is going to end up becoming addicted to these shows. And we have another little bit where it's at night, and Alex, he decides that he's going to raid the fridge.
This delivers probably one of my favorite lines in the movie. Of course she doesn't have a microwave. She's 100 years old.
I thought for sure that when Alex came back home with the black box, that Grandma was still going to be sitting there still playing the video game.
Oh, how funny. Yeah, no. But Alex gets hungry because, you know, munchies. Be honest. Did that tray of food look pretty good?
Kind of did.
Oh, it was way too much food.
I thought there was going to be a fire.
Yeah, so did I. I thought that's where it was going to. And then I also started thinking, can you put spaghetti in an oven like that?
It would just come out real crispy.
Oh, would it?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. Believe it or not, I've never tried that. So there you go.
So Alex has a little bit of Mary Jane and the food.
And he goes down and, okay, I will admit, I've done this once or twice. Not to the...
Really?
Just when I open it up and I go in and I go, oh, yeah. It hits me right away, but sometimes he pulls it out and he burns his hands naturally, and now he can't do his levels.
Yeah. I love how he goes into work and he blames it on the women that they were dominating him.
Right. Right. And of course they all buy it up.
Yeah.
You know, so
Samantha, she is not pleased, and he gets a little bit of a carpet call from her.
Right.
Because you got to get your levels done. You're a video gamer. You need your hands.
And not only that, but you are like the senior member, or Samantha's counting on him to lead by example. And from what she saw in the break room, he is the master, right? He's the one everybody looks up to. So yeah, they have a little meeting and he's got to get it done and he needs to start taking it seriously.
He goes back home and there's Grandma, and she is hooked on a cooking channel. Apparently she's been watching it for hours.
Right. And then this is where they turn it, right?
Well, he switches it to
the Antiques Roadshow.
So, I kept thinking, why is he getting even more hooked when he needs the TV?
Yeah. And by doing so, he also hooks Grace. And so now all of the roommates, you know, because Bee's in her own world and whatever. But so now there's an addiction to Antique Roadshows. And he's got to get his fucking levels done.
Yeah, he gets up the next morning at 6 a.m. and... holy shit, the ladies are still there in front of the TV. And then from there, he decides, well, I'm just going to go in early to the office. But does he get any work done? No, he goes to sleep.
Well, he's fucking tired.
The next little bit we get is, since Alex is asleep, Jeff gets challenged to Dance Dance Revolution.
Is this good? Did I do okay? Wow, this looks really hard. He suckers that kid so good.
I love how he plays off. He goes, oh, okay, we... you know, I guess we'll give it a shot. You go first and show me how it's done.
Yeah, he totally suckers him. New high score. What does that mean? Is that bad?
Did I break it?
What we have happen next is a reveal that throws into question, potentially, how JP is so good at what he does. JP's working in his office and Kane comes in and he has a recommendation that might make the game a little bit easier because on two different levels, you have two different characters that look very similar. So he suggests maybe you change their color. That would be easy to do, a day's work.
Right. And JP dismisses him, tells him to fuck off, and then goes up to Samantha and says, hey, I got this brilliant fucking idea.
Uses Kane's idea. And so now, you know, we are led to believe that potentially, how many times has he done something like this before?
Right.
Well, I got the impression that maybe he, in the recent time, maybe he had done that before. Although I think that would have been better known at the office that he had been doing that. I think it's more of, we're realizing that he peaked at the age of 13. Whenever that first or second game came out, he peaked and now he's, you know, there's nothing more to him. He's struggling on making his own game. He can't get things figured out. He has to steal other people's ideas. So I'm guessing he's on the decline at this point.
And you can see it happening. Mm-hmm. So JP doing this, although very, very much a douchebag move, and it just goes into us not liking him as a character more and more.
I also felt like this scene set us up for a later scene in which, you know, Alex shows JP the game. You know that if he stole the idea from Kane, he's probably going to try to steal the game from Alex.
In a New York second.
Yeah, you saw that coming a mile away. Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah. The moment that happened, it's like, oh, okay, I see what's going to happen.
Yeah. But that gave us our drama, if you will.
Mm-hmm. We have Alex's roommates show up at work to drop some lunch off for him, and they happen into Samantha.
And now the jig is up.
Well, I just love before the jig is up, when Alex is underneath the desk and Jeff is trying to kind of stand in front so nobody can see him, even though he's obviously there. And the three introduce him as his roommates. So they're all like, oh my God, he's doing these old ladies. And they're all like, yeah, we work him pretty hard, but it's nice having a young viral thing at home. And
right. A lot of innuendo there.
And he's like, oh, okay, enough of this.
Thanks, Grandma. And then Jeff's line. Yeah. What does he say?
Coming on my mom is one thing, but doing your grandmother, legendary.
That's such a boy thing to say.
So yeah, so now all the guys know he lives with Grandma.
And so needing screen time and needing to finish his levels.
And he still hasn't been working on it.
He gets Grandma and the roommates tickets to the Antiques Roadshow. And he comes in, he says, all right, ladies, you got to go to bed. And they do, and he gets his levels done, and he comes in the next day. And I like how
the game, Jeff... They're trying to cover for Alex.
Yeah.
Cover his ass.
And then Jeff and I think it's Jonah Hill's character maybe are sitting there.
It's Jeff, Barry, and Kane.
Yeah. And they're like, is this going to fucking happen? And they're super fucking stressed out about it.
Well, I love how they were saying, you know, Jonah Hill's character said, are we going to get fired? And he's like, well, just maybe you.
Right.
Right. And Kane's sitting there in the corner saying, you know, I'm so stupid. I maybe somewhere in the mix of this happens one of my favorite scenes, and I don't remember exactly where it happens, where we go back to Dante's basement or whatever it is, and we've got the Taekwondo instructor, and we've got the doctor, and they're talking about the monkey, and you could hear some banging around upstairs. So they send the Taekwondo guy to deal with the monkey. He gets his ass kicked, and then you see Alex goes to the stairwell to see what's going on, and the monkey comes flying down the stairs with his kick. And I love how the next scene we have is, again, Alex explaining how his roommates are so rough with him.
Right.
He's got the black eye.
I think that's when he goes to pick up the cable box.
Is that one of
these? I think so.
That was just so funny.
Yeah, the monkey.
One of my favorite scenes.
So then we have a scene where they're all sitting around the boardroom table, and Mr. Cheezel, he has somebody in there wants to make sure that the bad energy troll stays away. But he's very pleased because of the progress that they've made. And so, you know what, Samantha, why don't you take them out?
Right, right. After Alex and his coworkers finish successfully testing Eternal Death Slayer 3, Their boss, Mr. Cheezel, tells Samantha to take the boys out to eat at a vegan restaurant, but they instead make fun of the restaurant and their waiter, Shiloh, when they arrive, and then leave to a burger shop. When Jeff has to use the bathroom and refuses to use the one in the restaurant, Alex is forced to take everyone to his house. Alex comes home to find that Lily, Grace, and Bee drank all of his pot, which they thought was tea. When Samantha admits to smoking weed too, Alex calls up Dante and throws a wild party. During the party, the group prank calls JP and makes fun of him about wanting to be a robot. JP is upset by the message and shows up at Lily's house a couple nights later in tears. Feeling bad for him, Alex agrees to let him borrow his only copy of Demonic and test it out for a few days. So the game is on track, and Mr. Cheezel says, take him out, go celebrate. And they end up at this vegan restaurant.
Before they get to the restaurant, though, Samantha asks JP if you want to come along.
Oh, right, right.
No, no, no. He's got Buffy the Vampire Slayer, and he really wants her to come over.
Which I totally understand. It's Buffy.
Really?
Yeah, did you ever watch Buffy the Vampire Slayer?
A couple times.
Yeah, I can. Like I said, I kind of get JP.
Yeah, you do, and I'm starting to see it, and it's scaring me just a little bit.
I'm gonna have to get me one of those jackets.
do clothes cost money in the Matrix? Yeah, and then they go out to the restaurant, and David Spade has a cameo here.
Mm-hmm. Nick Swartzen said this was a tough scene to get through because every time, you know, David Spade would do that rant, he would do it differently. He would ad-lib it every time. And they said that they were just rolling. It was hard to keep a straight face during that.
Oh, I couldn't imagine. I couldn't imagine being on set with David Spade.
Would you have eaten at that restaurant?
No, not even a little bit. What about you?
I'd have a glass of water, I suppose.
Wheatgrass.
Did they have water?
I don't know. I think it was just wheatgrass, shots of wheatgrass.
And they walk in and they're all, yeah, let's get the alcohol, blah, blah, blah. And yeah, there's no alcohol.
The only shots we have here are wheatgrass.
That's right.
Go eat a hamburger and choke on a cow dick.
Yeah, because they give David Spade such a hard time. Mm. So they go and they get burgers. And this is where Samantha starts to open up a little bit more and let her guard down. And it turns out that Jeff has to go to the bathroom. What does he say? I have to pee, but I have to pee out of my butt.
I think we've all had these friends who will not use public restrooms. Have you ever had a friend like that?
Yeah, absolutely.
And so they're always like, you know, we got to go to somebody's house. Who's the closest house that you can get to?
Right. And so they all go back to grandma's house.
And they've already dug into their tea.
Right.
In honor of, was it honor of
Sophie?
Sophia.
Yeah. Yeah. And so when they get there, it turns out that grandma,
they are laughing their asses off.
Grace and Bee are fucking hammered.
Well, this brings up a point I was thinking about when I watched this movie. Obviously, I don't have a whole lot of experience with this kind of thing, but would boiling pot like that, would it have such a strong effect?
No.
He says no.
You don't think so?
No.
Have you tried it?
No.
Oh, then how do you know?
I read it recently.
Oh, did you?
I know that they put, you know, the stuff in colas and things like that. You can get things in candy and brownies and they cook it and stuff. But I was wondering if you just took some, maybe even put it in a little tea packet or something and did that, would it make something that would knock you on your butt like that?
Probably not, but it's fun for the movie. And
my grandma drank all my pot.
And this is where Samantha's like, oh, well, if you had...
That's too bad.
I know. If you had some pot, I could definitely smoke a J.
I would take a little bit.
Yeah. And so Jeff's like, call Dante. And Samantha's like, yeah, call Dante. And Alex is like...
I was surprised by that.
Yeah.
I love his reaction. Something like, you know...
Calm down, girl. I'll get you your fucking drug fix.
Yeah.
Something like that. Yeah. And so Dante shows up and he invites some people. A lot of people. And now we're on into a full-on house party. What'd you guys think of this bit?
I was surprised that grandma and her friends were at the party as well.
Were you?
Yeah. It's like, they came along too?
Well, they was at grandma's house.
Yeah, but I...
No, that was at Dante's place.
No,
that's at grandma's house.
That was grandma's house.
I thought that was at Dante's place.
No. They don't have a party at Dante's house until the end.
Did they end up with all of those people back at grandma's house?
Because Dante invited everybody.
Dante basically, they made some comment that there was a bar or something nearby that Dante was at or with some people, and he brought the entire bar with him.
That's how there was all those people. And I like this bit because grandma and her friends are just, you know, going along for the ride. And this is where Grace starts to flirt a little bit with Jeff.
We get a fun little tracking shot too. We have that gal with the mohawk walking down the hallway into the kitchen, and we see all of our characters engaged to some degree with other people from during the party.
Right. Right.
I just appreciated Doris, grandma going around and making all these different things for people to eat. And like, she serves them ice cream sandwiches, which was literally lettuce, tomato, bread, and ice cream.
And ice cream. Yeah.
And just, you know, having that whole argument about the captain's crunch or whatever it was.
And then she takes the cereal away.
Yeah. You don't get it and gives it to the other guy.
It gives it to the biker. I love that bit. I love that bit.
And then, of course, you get the, as you brought up, the flirting with Jeff and Grace.
Yeah.
Yeah. Awkward.
I thought it was hilarious.
This is where, again, some of the best lines happen, which was like one of them. She talks about she gave Charlie Chaplin a hand job.
Was he silent?
Not after I was done with him.
And then she mentions, is it, she mentions Laurel and Hardy? Which one?
Both.
She's a slut.
Hey, good on her. Mm-hmm. Good on her.
Samantha happens to find JP's card. And she whips it out, and next thing you know, the guys are insistent.
Did you notice
they need to call him?
Did you notice the card was laminated?
No, I didn't even catch that.
I hadn't caught that previously, but if you look closely as she whips it out, he had given her a laminated card.
Oh, that's funny. Because he's back in his loft with the techno music blasting, and
right,
he's having his internal conflict and his internal conversation with himself.
There was actually an issue during the filming of Back at JP's Place. Did you read about that one?
No.
The director, cinematographer, whoever, they were trying to follow him along while he was on that little, what do they call him?
Segway.
Segway. Well, he's doing a Segway, and they were following him along, and they had to cut the scene because the director ran into the wall.
Oopsie daisies.
Yeah.
Back at the party, Barry ends up getting boobs in his face.
How could you not love boobs?
It's just such an odd thing, you know. Was it, said, does baby want a sucky or something? What did she say to her?
Or milk.
Yeah,
or something like that. Milk. And yeah. Yeah, I mean, what are you going to say?
And I just love that from the rest of it, his face is just buried, but every so often he like puts up a thumbs up. Or,
right, right. And
Alex and Sam, they seem to be getting closer. They're playing a game together, but then eventually they end up, Dante, he's pouring shots. So Alex takes one, but Sam takes two.
Just, you know, rub it in a little bit. Mm-hmm.
She's very, very competitive.
Yeah. And then she goes and she starts to do karaoke to Push It.
I loved, you know, her whole thing about doing the Push It and all that. And then when she passes out, Alex comment,
I fucking love this woman.
That was just perfect.
Yeah. Yeah. This is good.
In the meantime, we have we have Jeff and Grace. You know, she's talking about all those different exploits, and you were a dirty old whore. What do you mean were?
And so it's up. On. It's on. And the next morning, Samantha is up bright and early, it would appear, and she's having a nice conversation with Grandma.
And Alex wakes up on the counter.
On the fucking counter. Have you ever woken up on a counter?
Yes.
Yeah.
No, I think it was more of a table, but yeah.
What about you?
No.
No?
I actually, when I was in college, my freshman year, thought about rushing a fraternity, so I went to a fraternity party, and all I remember is they were giving me drinks all night, and it started out as like an orange screwdriver, and it kept getting clearer and clearer all night, to the point where I woke up in a bedroom, didn't have my shoes and socks on, didn't know have a coat or anything. It was cold outside. I went out to try to find a bathroom, couldn't remember what room I was in, so I couldn't go find my shoes or my jacket. Ended up having to walk back to the dorms about half a mile just in bare feet and didn't know anything that happened that night.
You play dumb games, you win dumb prizes.
Yeah. When I went back to get my stuff, they informed me that I had agreed to join the fraternity.
Oh, well, good job.
So I never did. I got my stuff and never went back.
Oh, well, that's what happens.
Cool story.
Cool story, bro.
So as Grandma and Samantha look at the pictures together, eventually it's time to give her a lift back to the hotel. And back at the hotel, kind of sweet.
It is. I like what he says. You know, he drops her off, walks down, and goes, oh, fuck, I forgot my ticket. Walks back, and he opens the door, and she kisses him. And he goes, wait, how do you know I wasn't the bellboy? And she says something like, well, I was kind of wishing you were. So it's a little playful
banter. Well, I also like the comment of, I just came back from my parking pass. And she goes, I know. Because she knew she had it.
Oh, well, yeah, there you go.
Cut to Jeff and Grace. They're in bed.
When Jeff rolls over and goes, God, I knew I should have worn a condom.
Well, before that was the great where he goes, just so you know, you were my first.
She's like, you were like my 3,000th.
And that's when he rolls over and goes, God, I should have worn a condom.
Yeah. After they high five, which I thought was cute.
Yay, you.
Yeah.
JP ends up seeing the message on his phone and he listens to it.
I love his comment of,
how did I miss that?
Somebody left me a message?
Yeah.
I am not amused. So Jeff, he's talking about his exploits now back in the break room with all the other little guys. And God, that one comment about, you know, how great it is to get a blowjob with a finger in your asshole.
Did they say that she invented that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure she invented that.
My next question is, no, I'm just kidding.
And of course, they bring up the fact that Jonah is like, and Jonah got to suck on his first boobie, and he yells out for 13 hours.
Yeah, yeah.
So JP shows up in the room, and hey, where's Alex? Oh, him and Samantha, they went out to lunch together.
And he's all kinds of jealous, because of course, naturally, JP has a big old crush on Samantha.
And you'd think that the next scene you would see is JP trying to get some revenge, but no, what we get to see is him bawling and drooling in front of Alex.
You know, he goes to Alex's grandma's house and he breaks down and he just wants to be part of the
ugly cry.
Yeah. And he just wants to be part of the crowd. And I like what Alex says. Well, quit being so fucking weird.
Yeah, I'll tell the guys to back off a bit.
Yeah. And so then foolishly, Alex tells him about, or no, JP sees the game.
Yeah.
And then Alex tells him about it, his game Demonic, and JP, being the conniving little fuck that he is,
offers to take a look at it, give him some notes on it.
And I don't know what Alex is thinking.
Well,
I would be like, I'm good.
Well, I got the impression that even though they give JP a hard time, Alex still kind of thinks that this guy is a progeny and that he's a genius. And so the fact that this guy who invented these other two games, you know, him giving him feedback is a big thing. So I kind of thought that he was a little bit starstruck at that moment, that he's willing to look at my game.
Maybe.
What sealed the deal for me when I knew exactly what was going to happen. I knew what was going to happen, but when he says, don't tell anyone about it. I haven't told anybody about this, so don't tell anyone.
Right, so perfect opportunity for JP to kick him in the balls.
Mm-hmm.
Do not ring the bell. There is nobody home. The spirits around will haunt you. Do not ring the bell.
In retaliation for Alex making his life miserable and having become accustomed to stealing others' ideas, JP steals the game and tries to pass it off as his own work. Mr. Cheezel does not believe Alex when he insists the game is his since it was his only copy, so his friends call Lily to the office. Because she has mastered the game already, she plays JP and wins to prove it belongs to Alex. JP is fired by Mr. Cheezel while Alex is vindicated and creates a successful game. Alex and Samantha start dating. Roll credits. So we're coming home here to the third act, and JP has stolen Alex's game, and Alex comes to work and everyone's like, you got to check this out. JP's game's ready. It's ready. It's ready. And he turns it on. And what do you think JP is actually thinking? I mean, Alex is sitting right there. Of course he's going to challenge him on it.
Mm-hmm. I thought the same thing of he's demoing his own, you know, Alex's game in front of Alex. You know Alex is going to flip out.
I think he was counting on it, probably.
That way they could get into a he said, she said type of thing, maybe?
Or maybe Alex would get fired because he really just wanted to get Alex out to have the girl to all himself, Samantha all to himself.
Well, maybe.
That too, potentially.
But everybody believes JP and nobody believes Alex.
Well, Samantha does.
That's a good point.
Yeah, the big thing is that Alex has just, you know, positioned himself as a game tester. Nobody knows he has programming knowledge.
True that. And so he gets all kinds of fed up and he fucking quits.
Rage quits.
Yeah, runs out. And where does he go? Dante's.
And what plan does he have at Dante's?
I fucking love this plan. This plan works every day of the week and twice on Sundays.
And we all need to have a friend like Dante.
Well, it's legal now, so you can just go to the pot shop.
What I mean is that, you know, he immediately says, I want you to take this, this, and this. I want you to put them all into one big thing. And Dante's like, you know what? You're going to do that? I'm going there with you.
Good friend. Good friend.
In the meantime, we have Samantha shows up at Alex's place, and Grandma, she's out in the front yard working, and it just comes into, is it about the game?
And they're like, you know about the game?
Oh, yeah. And so it just, it plays itself the way that it needs to play.
Yeah. Yeah. Very paint by numbers. Samantha takes Lily back to the office to get this all squared away.
I liked how everyone's trying to figure out what Alex is, and Jeff's like, I know right where Alex is.
Yeah. Yeah. And then this is the bit too, where he calls Alex.
I love the fact that we hear the phone ringing and you see Dante start looking around and he's like, what is that ringing? He's like, I think that's your phone. He goes, oh, thank God. I thought I had a tumor.
Oh, right. Right. And when they answer the phone, obviously Alex is super fucking high. And
I think it's the devil calling you.
Yeah.
Is this the scene where Alex and the monkey are playing and then we see that the screen is off?
Yep. They're playing video games and the screen's off and the Alex is like, dude, you're so good at this. And then after they call.
And how do they entice him to come in? Jeff comes up with this bold-faced lie about that JP has turned into a robot and he's kidnapped his grandma and he's going to eat her soul out of her head.
And he asks Dante, he says, you got to take me in. Dante says, I'm way too big to go to the devil's house. Let's have the monkey drive. And so they go, and I didn't think they were really going to do it, but they did it. They got the monkey to drive.
I kept wondering, was that really happening or was that in their head that the monkey was driving?
Oh, who knows?
Either way, it's hilarious.
Yeah, absolutely.
And the way they're just kind of all screaming and going all over the place.
Yeah. And so they make it back to the office, and
So they confront Mr. Cheezel that they have proof.
And so they bring in Lily and JP, and they have a game off. But what I liked about this bit was, you know, Grandma's kicking his ass, and then JP starts to win a little bit, and then Grandma does something that even JP hasn't seen. And the expression on JP's face when it happens, he's like, oh, fuck. He knew he was caught.
Mm-hmm.
And so I like what Mr. Cheezel says. I'm going to call your mom and tell her to come pick you up.
What I liked is when he's leaving and he says to Samantha, you know, in the robot voice, please sit on my face. You can hear Mr. Cheezel back going, not appropriate.
Not appropriate. That's right.
Now, I didn't think he got fired. I just thought he got escorted out for the day because he just said, I'm going to call your mom to come pick you up. Do you think he actually got fired? Or does it even matter?
It's inconsequential.
To me, it doesn't matter. Yeah, I never thought about it. If I did, I would think that he got fired.
And now the audience learned that it is now 6 months later.
And they're playing demonic.
And so Alex's game is a hit.
They're all in Dante's basement.
And him and Samantha, they're seeing each other or whatever. And Dante has gotten a lion, a monkey.
And we end with
an elephant. What did you guys think of this whole bit?
It was bombastic.
The word that popped into my head as soon as this movie was over, it's absurd.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This movie's fucking absurd, but it's a good absurd, at least I think.
Yeah.
So
it's a good movie that when you need to watch something that you don't have to take seriously, you just want the classic lines, you just want the stoner jokes, just doesn't take any brain power for this movie.
Right. And that's Grandma's Boy.
Welcome to a new segment we like to call
Face the Wheel.
The premise is simple. I will spin the wheel, and whatever category comes up, John and Don will apply it to the movie we are reviewing. Once they have presented their idea, it's up to you, the listeners. Let us know via social media or our website which idea you like best. Here are the categories: mashup, plot, rename, genre, reboot, fuck it. I liked it better when it was called Spin Again. Pick any. Add any character from any movie. And here we go. And our category is genre.
For me, if I was going to choose a different drama than, you know, this comedy stoner flick, I would have kept obviously all the drugs in it, but I would have gone with more of a drama version of it, more of a gangster feel, and done a Wolf of Wall Street version of Grandma's Boy, in that, you know, he's this high successful game tester, blah, 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 all cutthroat and everything, but still living at Grandma's house.
And kind of has the Jordan Belfort mentality.
Yeah.
Is it directed by Martin Scorsese?
Could be. Can you imagine Grandma's Boy directed by Martin Scorsese?
Yeah, and fucking Leo is fucking...
We already had Jonah Hill in it.
Yeah, I'll buy it. I'll buy the genre. The genre was what?
I'd go for kind of a drama slash gangster.
Drama slash gangster? Okay, okay. I will see your drama slash gangster, and I will raise you. Grandma's Boy is a horror flick.
Shirley Jones is the killer.
No, I would, I think I would go so far as to say it's Grandma and Shirley Jones. But my point is, Grandma's Boy as a horror with all of the weed elements you can keep in. You can keep in some of the jokes as it lightens the mood. But as a horror flick, they all work for this gaming tech company, and it's the eve before the launch of the new game, and there's a killer loose. And they all end up back at Grandma's house. And it's Grandma. Grandma is the killer because reasons.
She wants her son Alex to be the successful.
Well, no, Alex is the first one to die.
Oh, I thought Alex was the last one because Grandma's doing it. And then she kills them all and turns them into tea.
Hey, whose fucking genre is this?
I'm just pitching ideas to everybody. But yeah, she puts them all in the tea.
I think your marijuana should be laced with horrible hallucinogenic junk that causes people to be in anguish so Grandma can torture them.
Oh, look at the dark twist this motherfucker just gave us.
Can you imagine if Demonic was a game that actually like came to life and like it was all about bringing the demon out of the game?
It's writing itself, guys. It's writing itself.
And there you have it, listeners. Let us know via social media or our website who you thought had the better use of category. And that concludes this week's
Face the Wheel.
All right, what do you guys think? You guys ready to rate this flick?
I'm ready to rate this flick. John, are you ready to rate this flick?
Hold on one sec. Wait, what? What are we doing?
Are you ready to rate this flick?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Hey, Professor, how do we do our ratings?
We do our ratings on a scale of 1 to 5 fucks. 5 fucks is a movie that we think is cinematic gold. A 1 fuck movie is a movie where you watch it once and you're done. And you're never going to watch that again.
And what's a zero?
A zero fuck movie is you get done watching it and you're like, oh, for shit's sake, what the hell? Why did you make me watch this? I want 1 hour and 34 minutes of my life back.
Or in other words, we just don't give a fuck. All right, your pick, you go.
You'd like me to go first?
You picked it out of the fucking helmet, didn't you?
I think so. I'm having a lot of troubles remembering.
Well, that's what happens when you keep hitting the bong.
Yeah.
Speaking of which, pass that motherfucker over this way.
All right, here, catch. Before I do, would you like to guess what my rating's going to be?
I got it wrong last week, right?
Yeah, you were wrong.
I fucking got it wrong for Rocky, and I'm still kind of kicking myself. With Grandma's Boy, it's comedy, stoner comedy. You like those, but I think you like the dodgeball ones better. I think you're going to give Grandma's Boy 3.5 fucks.
Final answer?
Final answer.
Okay. So Grandma's Boy is one of those movies that, as I mentioned before, is a great movie when you need to turn your brain off, when you just need something that's just funny, that has a lot of just classic one-liners, and is really, I mean, it boils down to just being a classic stoner flick. It's a reason why this movie is a cult classic. I thought everybody who was in this movie, all the acting, they did a great job. It's not an award-winning movie. It's not a movie that, you know, is super well-written, but it has a fun, entertaining storyline. You know, people who know me that I'm a big fan of dodgeball and those style of movies. And this movie fits right into that genre. So I really enjoyed this movie. And, you know, I've seen it a bunch of times. It had been a while since I'd seen it. And when I saw it first go into the Bronco helmet, I was really looking forward to this one coming up. So I'm glad we got to review it. We got to watch it. So I'm just thrilled with this movie. And for those reasons, don't judge me, monkey. I'm giving Grandma's Boy 3.5 fucks.
That's a bingo. Right back on track, baby. Right back on track. All right, you and me there, tough guy.
You go first.
Grandma's Boy. I, like you, John, got excited when I saw it go into the Bronco helmet. And then when I saw who put it in the Bronco helmet, I went, oh, it makes sense. There are a bunch of different types of comedies out there, and stoner comedies are, you know, hold a little special place in my heart. I think they're funny. And if written right and acted right, it's mindless fun. And Grandma's Boy is no different. I think it ranks up there with the stoner comedies that I like, the Half Bakes, the all of the other ones. And what I like about this one is I think the writing is sharp, and I think that Adam Sandler and his production company does a great job at putting the right people together for the right movie. No one was over the top. No one seemed out of place in this film, and that's important, especially when you're dealing with stoner comedies. The cast was good. The soundtrack was fine. The movie is passable, as in it's put together fundamentally well. The story is pretty simple, A to B, and it gets us there. And I just have a lot of fun with it. I'm giving Grandma's Boy 3.5 fucks.
All right. I guess that leaves little old me.
Should we guess his rating before he gives it?
For Grandma's Boy, you're going to give it 2.5 fucks.
I'm going to say he's going to give it 2 fucks.
All right. Fire away, Professor.
Just so you know, I already have it picked out, and it's neither one of those.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
We aimed too high.
So, Grandma's Boy. I had not heard or seen this movie before, and I knew that it was going to be a lighthearted, not to be taken serious movie, and I was open for that. The movie is going to be something that I'm going to have to, you know, be open-minded about, because I'm a middle-aged man watching this by myself, and so I don't necessarily have an audience to help carry me along, you know, that helps to get me into the mood of the movie. What I found with the movie is that all of the characters are likable, and none of the characters are despicable. And the antagonist of the movie, he's not really an antagonist. He's just a, you know, he's just a misunderstood guy. I think that he's isolated himself and he just doesn't know how to fit in. My favorite character far and away was Samantha. Alex was a lot of fun. And all of the little tidbits that happened throughout the movie, you know, courtesy of Alex and his friends, Jeff, Barry, and Kane, I thought worked just fine. The movie doesn't necessarily have any specifically memorable moments that say that was fucking awesome. There's definitely several fun scenes with it. You know, the bit with Alex in the little doll scene, you know, where he gets caught. The bit where they have the food in the oven. It's like, why are you, okay, I guess it's because he's too fucking stoned. And for him to forget that, to have that go flying everywhere. I thought it was really amusing having the party happening at the house. All of the characters, I think, work just fine in this movie. And I think, even though I'm not going to watch it again under my own, you know, by myself, because I don't necessarily gravitate towards the movie, it's a simple, fun watch. It's lighthearted, and I'm giving it 2.75 fucks.
2.75 fucks. Coming in higher than both what we suggested there, John. Look at this guy. With 3.5 fucks from me and the comic book guy and 2.75 fucks from the professor, that gives Grandma's Boy an average of 3.25 fucks, which puts it in the 21st spot, tied with Dr. Sleep, Once Upon a Time in Mexico, Chef, Dr. Strange in the Multiverse of Madness, Roadhouse, and RoboCop. It is slightly better than Ratatouille, Galaxy Quest, Red Dawn, and The Last Samurai. It is slightly worse than Mallrats, Big, The Greatest Showman, and Scarface. So there you have it, boys. All right, that is going to wrap it up for this episode of Three Guys in a Flick. If you would like to know which movie we're going to be reviewing next, please check out the website. And speaking of which, John, where can they find us?
I have no clue. But if they were looking, they could always go to threeguysinaflick.com, where you can find all of our show notes, our podcasts, as well as anything else we feel like putting there. And there's a form on there where you can submit what movies you would like us to review next, as well as give us a little bit of feedback. You can also find us at all of social media, as well as any place that hosts podcasts. And While you're listening to us, go ahead and give us a comment, a like, subscribe, help us build our numbers, and we would, again, love to hear back from you what you like or dislike about the show.
All right. I just want to thank Colm again for dropping this into the Bronco helmet. We had a lot of fun watching it and reviewing it. We hope you had a lot of fun listening to it. I also want to thank anyone else who listens and who submits a movie. If you keep listening, we'll keep recording. For Three Guys in a Flick, I'm Don.
I'm Stoned.
And I'm Ken. Thanks for listening.
Released on January 6th.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Hit me again one more time. I apologize.
Put the bong down.
Yeah, this is good shit, man. I'm starting to see antlers. You guys are, as of the last couple of weeks, I've decided you guys are going to make me keep score.
I never kept score.
I know. That's why every week ended a tie. What fun is that? And then it came down to one question.
Yeah.
All year came down to one question. Ken was pissed.
That was awesome.
He was all kinds of fired up. He was like, how come we didn't have a fucking tournament? Where was the fucking bracket? I said, hey, man, John runs the show, not me. But he has the opinion of moving in with his grandma.
Option.
Maybe I need to stop smoking the brown bomber.
On his own, and he gets challenged to a new video game, Dance Dance Revolution.
Ready, tough guy.
As soon as you're done yawning.
All right, what you got, Professor?
Nothing.
Fucker.
This seems like an easy one.
I think so, too. What do you got?
I had two, but obviously Grandma's Boy Toy.
Okay.
And Grandma's Benoit Balls.
I just simply had Grandma's Toy. So, you know.
Yeah, it could be
Grandma
solo
is,
film.
Yeah, Grandma's into her self-reflection.
Yeah.
You know.
Sometimes you want the gray bush.
Yeah, well, no one loves us better than ourselves. All right, may all of your days and nights be filled with happiness. All right, fuck off. Good night.